Hello dear fans, friends and subscribers, this is your host Ram welcoming you to your daily edition, I would say the weekly edition of the Cricket Happening Show. And what we are looking at today is the second test match between India and West Indies. And what a match. Jasprit Bumrah, who created a real stir in the West Indian camp with his wonderful bowling in the first test match, discovering or probably saying that perfecting the outswinger, now went one better than that, as today he became the third Indian bowler to claim a test hat-trick as he dismissed three batsmen, Darren Bravo, Shamar Brooks and Roxton Chase, in three consecutive deliveries to become the third Indian bowler to take a hat-trick. And when stumps were drawn, the West Indies were really struggling in the second test at 87 for 7, with Jasprit Bumrah wreaking complete havoc in the West Indian camp once again, as his bowling figures read 9.1 overs, 3 maidens, 16 runs and 6 wickets. So Bumrah continued to haunt the West Indies. And before that, we saw India get on to a total of 416. Hanuma Vihari went on to make his maiden test ton. And Ishan Sharma, surprise of surprises, went on to make his maiden 50 and his highest score in test cricket of 57. So these are the features of the day, and I'll be coming to that. The other thing that is coming up tomorrow, two matches coming up. One is the one-off test between Sri Lanka and New Zealand. The T20 series, which is beginning between Sri Lanka and New Zealand. And also the one-off test match begins. It's still time. Tomorrow is going to be the Bangladesh Cricket Board 11 taking on the Afghanistan 11 in a sort of a warm-up game. But let's talk about the match here. But I will be definitely recreating what Bumrah did, and that is the one I'm going to concentrate on today. So India resumed on their overnight score. It didn't take much time. In fact, with the very first ball, the first wicket fell when Rishabh Pant did not add to his 27, the very first ball from Jason Holder of the day, and Rishabh Pant was walking back to the pavilion as he was clean bowled by Jason Holder with a lovely in-swinger. So as you know, Holder could not lay his hand on the new, but he had been off the field for 7 overs, and immediately Yesterday, as you know, even though new ball was taken, Jason Holder could not take it, because there is a sort of a rule which says that if you're off the field, you have to be in the field for a certain period of time to go and take the new ball. And that was the reason Holder could not bowl. And here he comes on with the new cherry, the first over, the first ball of the morning. And it was a length ball outside the off stump. But there was some late in-swing. Pant was trying to lean into the drive shot, but what a ball. It really came back a long way and went on to hit the timber of Rishabh Pant. Rishabh Pant was gone, bowled by Holder for 27, 2 fours and 1 six. Hanuma Vihari was at the crease, and Jadeja was there. But Jadeja, well, could not contribute much. He was gone for 16. Cornwall getting his second wicket, one reckons, or what is the third wicket? Let me check that. Yes, Cornwall picked up 3 wickets in the match. So Cornwall definitely had a good match, a good innings, I would say, because Cornwall's spin actually accounted for the wicket of Jadeja, as Jadeja went for a big slog against Cornwall. But the advantage that Cornwall has is because of his height. The bounce was more, and Jadeja was gone as he gave an easy catch to the mid-on region. Bravo taking the catch. And with the score on 302 for 7, one probably thought India's tail was totally exposed, with Ishan Sharma, Mohammad Shami and Bumrah. And the other end, we had the poor Hanuma Vihari, who was really struggling today in the morning. but are slowly trying to get to grips. And now once Ishan Sharma came, Vihari started playing his strokes. He drove some drove some good deliveries for four, so the bowling of Holder and Roche. And Hanuma Vihari would have not even expected this, but Ishan Sharma gave tremendous support to Hanuma Vihari. In fact, from a score of 302 for 7 when India went for lunch, one would have thought that, you know, it's probably a matter of time, probably another 350 runs and, you know, it would be all over. And Hanuma Vihari had to really work for his century. But surprise of surprises, Ishan Sharma plugged on and really started playing like an accomplished batsman, driving very well through the covers, driving down the ground, and he was looking pretty much in total control against the West Indian bowlers. And Ishan Sharma probably has worked on his batting. That's what it looked like after looking at it, as the partnership really added some valuable runs for India. In fact, the partnership added 112 runs, and in the process, Hanuma Vihari's confidence on Ishan Sharma had increased, and Hanuma Vihari guided himself, guiding India to 400, and he guided himself to his maiden test, and he was absolutely happy when he got his century. As you know, Hanuma Vihari was really sussed up by the Aussies in Australia, and they really started testing him with the bouncer. But here Hanuma Vihari has learned his lessons well, and Hanuma Vihari went on to make 111, his maiden test done, with 16 boundaries. Ishan Sharma went on to make his maiden test 57 with 7 boundaries. Shami was out for naught, Bumrah not out for naught, India were all out for 416. Jason Holder bagging 5 for 77, 32.1 overs, 9 maidens, 77 runs and 5 wickets. Cornwall on his debut, 41 overs, 10 maidens, 105 runs and 3 wickets. Really did the bulwark of the bowling, one could say. And now it was the turn of the West Indies to take on the Indian bowlers. And let's see what really happened. It all started off with Jason Campbell's being the first wicket to go. Bumrah had started his spell, and Bumrah got Jason Campbell to go on the back foot, and the ball just moved a shade, and the outside edge had been taken, and Pant had neatly settled onto it, going to his left side. Wicket number 1, West Indies 9 for 1, Campbell gone, caught Pant, bowled Bumrah for 2, wicket number 1. The second wicket to go was that of Craig Brathwaite, again Bumrah into the act there. Now this was Bumrah bowling a fuller length. He got Brathwaite to drive at the delivery. There was a thin edge and another excellent catch by the wicketkeeper Pant behind the stumps. Brathwaite was walking back to the pavilion, caught Pant, bowled Bumrah 10 with 1 boundary. After Jason Campbell was gone, we had a hat-trick coming in from Bumrah. Now let's have a listen to this hat-trick that happened. Now this was a ball from Bumrah which was actually had pitched on the middle stump, and from the middle stump it turned towards the off stump, and Darren Bravo, before he could even realize it, the ball had already hit the outside edge of the bat, and KL Rahul had already grabbed onto it. And that was a Bravo walking back to the pavilion, and the West Indians were 13 for 2. And so that was the wicket of Bravo. So basically, this was again the outswinger starting to show its shape there, as 2 wickets were gone, and both of outswingers from Jasprit Bumrah. Now, after Darren Bravo was gone, we saw Shamar Brooks come in, and Shamar Brooks was the next victim of the very next delivery, collected a golden duck, as this was a ball which was swinging in from outside the arm. Now it was the case of an in-swinger. It actually swung in from the outside of the off stump. The ball came in, and in fact Brooks was trying to go across the line, but he was trapped in front of the middle stump. And that was the end of Shamar Brooks. LBW bowled Bumrah for naught. And now, Jasprit Bumrah was on a hat-trick. Virat Kohli immediately started piling on the pressure. He got three slips in, two gullies, one shot like one silly point, and he started hemming in Roston Chase, who came in, and Roston Chase succumbed to the pressure. Now another LBW full in swinger from Jasprit Bumrah, Roston Chase trying to flick at the delivery. Again, the ball swung. This time, it was the in swinger doing the work there, and would have gone on to hit the leg stump. In fact, the umpire did not give him out. Virat Kohli was certain that this was a wicket. He immediately called for a review, and that was it. Jasprit Bumrah became the third Indian Test bowler to go and grab a hat-trick in Test matches. And Bumrah was an absolute fire. All the four wickets to Bumrah, 13 for 3 when Brooks passed. And after that, it was Brathwaite who was really seeing it all happen. He was staying at the wicket, but it was not a happy picture at all for the West Indies, as Brathwaite was the next to go. Brathwaite's wicket was taken by Jasprit Bumrah. Now again, this was Brathwaite. This is the fifth wicket for Jasprit Bumrah. He got Brathwaite into the drive, and Brathwaite was gone. And West Indies were in the dumps there, 22 for 5. Brathwaite gone, Campbell gone, hat-trick taken, Bravo, Brooks and Chase gone to Bumrah. Bumrah had taken all the 5 wickets, 22 for 5. Bumrah had 5 in his bag. Now, the West Indian batting order needed resuscitation, and the resuscitation was provided by the pair of Jason Holder, the captain, and Solomon Hetmyer, and both started slowly getting in. Solomon Hetmyer started playing his strokes. Jason Holder was trying to rein himself in, but with the score going to 67, it was Mohammad Shami getting into the act, it was a ball which was which beat the inside edge of the bat of Hetmyer, and this was bowled in the corridor outside the off stump, Hetmyer wanted to drive at it, and it went on to uproot his middle stump as he missed it, as the ball beat him on the inside edge. So Hetmyer was gone for 34 with 7 fours. And then Jason Holder, before close of play, once again Bumrah getting his 6th wicket, and this was the important wicket that India needed, as Bumrah bowled a beautiful delivery to Jason Holder. It was a back of a length delivery. Holder had decided that he's going to have a go at it, and all that Holder could do was to get the ball in the air. Mid off was the substitute Rohit Sharma, settled under it, and Bumrah, as I said, was an absolute fire. West Indians were reeling at 78 for 7. Bumrah had got 6 wickets, and including a hat-trick. And finally, it was the Cornwall and Hamilton survived till the close of play. The two debutants, Jamar Hamilton, not out on 2. Rakim Cornwall, not out on 4. As West Indians closed the day, and I'm sure they would have been pretty relieved to go back into the dressing room, at the end of the day. 87 for 7, and India were an absolute fire. Looking at the bowling, look at Bumrah's figures. 9.1 overs, 3 maidens, 16 runs and 6 wickets to Jasprit Bumrah. 6.5 overs, 2 maidens, 20 runs and no wicket to Ishan Sharma. Mohammad Shami, 8 overs, 3 maidens, 1 for 19. And Jadeja, 9 overs, 5 maidens, none for 19. Savannah Park, Kingston, Jamaica. Indians in the Indian bowler, Bumrah, was an absolute fire. So that is as well. So definitely the West Indians having their backs to the wall. As I said, the pitch is definitely aiding something, but Bumrah is something that has become a sort of a conundrum for the West Indian batsmen. They are trying to find an answer to this, one could say, because the West Indians were trailing by 329 runs at close of play. They have only 3 wickets remaining, 2 debutants at the wicket. India would be fancied tomorrow probably to bowl them out, and one would probably see the West Indians following on, because they need to avoid a follow on. And that would be interesting to see, because looking at the way the pitch is playing, I wouldn't be surprised if Kohli decides to actually bat on and catch West Indies on the last day track. And it's quite possible, because looking at the way the pitch has been behaving, I'll be least surprised if Kohli decides to bat again and not enforce the follow on this particular pitch at Savannah Park in Jamaica, in Kingston. So that is as far as India versus West Indies were concerned. The next thing that I'm going to talk about is a very, very brief preview of the first match of the T20 series, which is coming up tomorrow. The match is between New Zealand and Sri Lanka. Let's say that, this is going to be an interesting thing. New Zealand having a lot of new blokes in their lineup. Sri Lanka has that talented player by the name of Avishka Fernando, who showed us all in the World Cup what a dangerous batsman he can be. Just 21 years of age, and he is someone who is such an attractive batsman to watch, no doubt about it. And also, there could be Wanindu Hasaranga coming into the attack as well. But it will be interesting. So if you look at the Sri Lankan team, Dhanushka Gunatilaka and Niroshan Dikwala, who is in form as he has already shown in the Test matches. Dhanushka Gunatilaka and Niroshan Dikwala. Dhanushka Gunatilaka is one who likes to go over the top. Niroshan Dikwala is an unorthodox opener. So I think it's a very good combination. And then they have Avishka Fernando coming in as one drop, which really strengthens it. And then Kushal Pereira, one knows what a thrasher he is of a cricket ball. And then they have Shehan Jayasurya. Then Dasun Shanaka is another very, very hard-hitting all-rounder. And then Wanindu Hasaranga. He also has the ability to bat, as we have seen. And besides, he's a wrist spinner. And then they have the balling coming. Isru Dana, Lasith Malinga, who is still playing the T20s, will be captaining the side. And they have Kasun Rajita and Lahiru Kumara, the pace bowler. So that is as far as the Sri Lankan team composition is concerned. Now let's have a look at the New Zealand team. The New Zealand team, Martin Guptill will open with Colin Munro. Colin Munro is back in business. Tim Seaford, the wicketkeeper, as you know, he played very well against India, as you would remember. He's a wonderful player. I mean, he's a very sort of a very busy player, one could say. Tom Bruce is another one who has a very good domestic record there back in New Zealand. With his way of good hitting. Ross Taylor for experience there. Colin D. Grantham did well in the Test matches. Mitchell Santon, another wonderful left-arm spinning all-rounder. And Todd Assell, the off-spinner, also could bat. And then the bowling would be in the hands of Lockie Ferguson, who did very well in his very first World Cup that he was playing. Tim Southee and Seth Rance, who played against India. And Seth Rance is a sort of an explosive pace bowler. He bowls at some real pace, but probably the control would be something that Seth Rance has to master. Probably that comes with experience. So Palakele will have some pace and carry, I am told. It will be interesting to see how really things go. So that's the tomorrow, as I said. Just a brief preview of the first ever, not the first ever, the first T20 match of the series, which is coming up between New Zealand and Sri Lanka. Well, dear fans, subscribers, I have nothing else to really add. It's about time for me to bid you all a very good night on this cricket show. But what I'm going to do right now is that this particular show, I will be posting it on my Twitter page. You can go and have a look at it. You want to have a look at YouTube, you can have a look at YouTube, or you can go on to my website, which is www.cricket-status.com. You can get into it and you can view it. I will be posting that video over there. Well, dear fans and subscribers, it was a real pleasure to talk to you all here on this cricket show today. It's your host Ram bidding you all a very good night.